So hello friends, in today's lecture of applied thermodynamics, today we will see a reverse Carnot refrigeration cycle. And before going to that refrigeration cycle, we will cover some basic of engines, that is heat engine, refrigerator and heat pump. Okay, so let's start today's video. Refrigeration. Now, what is the refrigeration? So it is that science or that technique by virtue of which we are able to maintain some space, some volume at lower temperature than the surrounding. That means suppose I put on AC, so I am maintaining temperature of that room as per my wish, as per the setting of that air conditioner. But that is maintaining lesser than the surrounding temperature, correct? If I am using a heater, then I am heating the room, and definitely outside surrounding atmospheric temperature will be lower, and I am maintaining my room temperature at higher temperature. Okay, so we are changing for our comfort the condition of our room or space other than the surrounding, and maintaining it, that comes under this refrigeration. If we are cooling it, then refrigeration. If we are heating it, then heat pump. But along with this, there is a heat engine. So heat engine, what is a heat engine? This might be covered in your thermodynamic also, but I will revise again. Heat engine. Imagine there is a heat source. Heat source is a heat reservoir which is at a higher temperature, and heat sink is a reservoir which is at a lower temperature. Heat source suppose at temperature T2 and heat sink at temperature T1. And here we are seeing this T2 is larger than T1. Correct. So heat source is higher temperature. Then we have one engine, that is heat engine. Now, what is the purpose of any engine? It is work developing device. Correct. So it take heat as an input, convert some part of that heat into useful work output, and remaining part of heat will be rejected to the heat sink, because it is not possible to convert all the heat supplied into equivalent amount of work. That is a basic laws are there, restrictions are there. So due to that, we are converting some part of our heat supplied into work output, and remaining part we have to reject it into the heat sink. So this is a heat engine where we obtain a work as an output. And this is quite possible, taking a heat from higher source, utilizing it to some mechanical work, and remaining part we will reject it. Okay, this is a heat engine. And what is our desired effect? What is our requirement? So in a heat engine, our requirement is a work output. Okay, our requirement is not rejecting the heat Q2 or supplying a heat Q1. Our desire, requirement or effect is work output. Next is refrigerator. Now suppose we are taking the same cases, heat source and heat sink. Heat source is at T2 temperature, heat sink is at T1 temperature. We know naturally it will transfer from high temperature to low temperature. So for transfer of heat from T2 to T1, we does not require any kind of efforts, because it is a natural high temperature to low temperature. It will easily transfer. But if we want to extract a heat from lower temperature and reject into the higher temperature. So imagine this heat sink is our refrigerator, our fridge. So inside a fridge already there is a temperature lower than our surrounding room temperature, but still we are extracting heat from refrigerator, from food content, and that heat is supplied to room with the help of condenser. Many fridges having a backside black coil is there, that is a condenser coil. So inside fridge already there is a lower temperature, but still we are extracting heat from food content and rejected into the atmosphere or room, which is at higher temperature. But this is against the natural law, and it is not possible automatically it can flow from lower temperature to higher flow temperature. So we have to supply some kind of work so that this make it possible to extract heat from lower temperature, that is heat sink, and reject into higher temperature, that is heat source. For natural process, no need to supply any work. Naturally, it will flow from high temperature to low. But to make it in a reverse, heat extraction for low temperature and supply to high temperature, we have to provide some work. And how we are supplying this work? With the help of compressor. So there is one spherical black shell is there in all fridge on bottom side especially. So that black spherical ball is nothing but a refrigerator, hermetically sealed compressor. And that compressor providing work to do such phenomena where heat transfer from low temperature to high temperature. And in this case, what is our requirement? Our requirement is extract of this Q1 amount, extraction of Q1 amount from heat sink. So refrigerator cabinet removal of heat is our desired effect. That means providing a cooling inside that refrigerator cabin is our desired effect. That is called refrigerating effect, cooling effect. Next is heat pump. Now when we use a heat pump in a winter season, or where the surrounding climate is very cold, okay, so in such a region we have to provide a heaters, room heaters. So we can use the same cycle to heat up a room. Suppose this refrigerator, in a refrigerator we are extracting Q1 amount of heat, so we get a cooling effect here. We are supplying W amount of work, and then whatever be the extracted heat and work done, that much amount of heat is rejected into heat source. Now in heat pump, again we are extracting Q1 amount of heat, but this time suppose, imagine we are living in a area where there is a snowfall, okay, so outside of our room or our house temperature is lesser. So suppose now outside of our room is a heat sink having a lesser temperature, still we are extracting heat from outside by providing some kind of work, and whatever be the amount of extraction of heat from outside, Q1 and W, that become Q2, and this higher heat we are supplying into our room, so our room get heated and maintain at higher temperature than the outside surrounding temperature. So this is a work of our heat pump. Now in the difference of refrigerator and heat pump, a refrigerator, our desired effect or requirement is cool down specific space, that means extraction of Q1 amount of heat, that is our desired effect. And in heat pump, our desired effect is supply heat, that is Q2 amount. This is our desired effect. That means we want to heat up our room. So desire effect gets changed. There is always one question, whether refrigerating cycle can be used to heat up a room. Yes, of course. We have to change the system. Now, heat sink will be the outside, cold atmosphere, and heat source will be our room. So refrigerator cycle can be used as a heat pump. Only our desired requirement will be amount of Q2 in heat pump, and Q1 extraction will be our desired effect in refrigerating. So this is the difference between heat pump, refrigerator, and heat engine. In all the cases, we are assuming heat source as T2 temperature, heat sink at T1 temperature. So everywhere we are mentioning T2 is at higher temperature than T1. Okay, you may draw schematic with a T1 as a heat source, T2 as a heat sink. Accordingly, your formula gets changed. So let's move ahead. Now, heat engine efficiency. Why we require to calculate the efficiency? Because in any engine, it is not possible to convert all the heat supply into work done. That means some amount of work will be, some amount of heat will be rejected, and that is a requirement of a system. Okay, otherwise your part get melted, get damaged. So we have to reject excess amount of heat. So how much portion of heat supplied get converted into work, that is calculated with the help of efficiency. So we can say this engine is more efficient. How it is more efficient? Because it is converting larger amount of heat supplied into work output. So it is more efficient. Okay. Now we will see how to reach to the final formula of heat engine efficiency. Basically, efficiency is nothing but a work output divided by heat supply. And very generic, we can say that efficiency is nothing but a desired output divided by required input. So here, desired output is work and required input is Q1 heat supply. So desired output work done W divided by Q1, that is a heat input. This will be our efficiency. Now we will see what is the work. So work is Q1 minus Q2, because Q1 amount is supplied, Q2 is rejected. So whatever be the difference of Q1 and Q2 get converted into work. So work will be Q1 minus Q2. This much is the work done divided by again Q1. If I simplify this, so Q1, Q1 get cancelled, it become 1 minus Q2 upon Q1. Now Q is nothing but a heat, and heat we normally calculate as MCP delta T. So if I am calculating heat supplied from T2 temperature heat source, so MCP T2. And if I am calculating Q2 amount rejected to heat sink, so I will calculate it as MCP T1. So Q2 will be MCP T1 and Q supplied, so MCP T2. Remember, we are considering T2 as a heat source. So this mass get cancelled, CP get cancelled. So we have a remaining only T1 minus T1 upon T2. This is our efficiency formula. Now remember, 1 minus sink temperature upon source temperature. If I change the notation, source temperature as T1, sink temperature as T2, then formula will be different, T2 upon T1. So efficiency of heat engine is 1 minus sink temperature upon source temperature. And now here we observe that it is 1 minus some quantity. Correct? So always remember, our heat engine never be 100%. It is always less than 1. That means 100%. Now next is a refrigerator. Now efficiency of refrigerator, such a term is not used. It is called as coefficient of performance. Okay, efficiency is related with the engine, but efficiency, even though it is equivalent to efficiency, but it is called as a coefficient of refrigerator. Now what is the coefficient of performance? That is COP. So COP of a refrigerating system is the ratio of refrigerating effect to the work supply. What is the refrigerating effect? So we know that refrigerating effect is a cooling effect we require. That is, this is our desired effect, desired requirement. And what is our input? So it is a work supply. So COP of any refrigerating cycle or refrigerator is nothing but a ratio of output, desired output upon required input. So here we have to supply work as an input, and our desired requirement is a extraction of Q1, cooling effect. So COP of refrigerator is nothing but a refrigerating effect, that is cooling effect, divided by input, that is a work supply. Refrigerating effect is nothing but a extraction of Q1 amount. So refrigerating effect is a Q1, and work supplied is W. Now how to calculate Q1 or W? So Q1 plus W, this much amount is rejected as Q2. So Q2 is Q1 plus W. So if I shift this Q1, so Q2 minus Q1 is a work. So Q2 is higher, Q1 is lesser than Q2. So we are extracting Q1 amount of it, adding with work, and this total amount is rejected to the heat source in a refrigerator. So if I calculating work, so it will be Q2 minus Q1. So our formula become Q1 upon Q2 minus Q1. Now putting Q1, that is MCP delta T, so heat extracted from heat sink, so MCP T1. So Q1 is MCP T1, here also MCP T1. What is Q2? So heat rejected to heat source, so MCP delta T, so here it will be MCP T2. So Q2 is MCP T2. Now simplify this. So here mass terms get cancelled, CP terms get cancelled. So remaining T1 upon T2 minus T1. So remember, T1 is a heat sink. So heat sink temperature divided by temperature of source and sink. This is a COP of a refrigerator. Now we will see COP of heat pump. So again, COP of heat pump, our desired effect is now heating a room, that is supply of Q2. This is our desired effect. So heating effect divided by input is work supplied. So COP of heat pump is Q2 upon work this time. Okay, heating effect is requirement, so Q2 upon W. Now how to calculate Q2? So Q2 is nothing but W plus Q1. So extraction of Q1 amount from outside cold atmosphere plus this work, and this much will be addition of Q1 and Q2 will be supplied to room to heat up it. So Q2 is W plus Q1. So Q2 is W plus Q1 divided by W, work input. Now here WW get cancelled, so it become 1 plus Q1 upon W. Now we know that Q2 minus Q1 is total work. So we are replacing W by Q2 minus Q1. So our formula become 1 plus Q1 upon Q2 minus Q1. Now what is Q1? So heat extracted from heat sink, low temperature, that is T1. So MCP T1, Q2 is heat delivered to heat source at T2 temperature. So Q2 become mCp T2 minus again Q1 mCp T1. Here m get cancel, Cp get cancel. So finally we obtain 1 minus T1 upon T2 minus T1. So what is this? Sink temperature divided by temperature difference of source and sink. And if we observe this, so this temperature difference is nothing but a COP of refrigerator. So COP of refrigerator is T1 upon T2 minus T1. So we can say that COP of heat pump is equals to 1 plus COP of refrigerator. And this is also many time asked in your oral exam. So remember, COP of heat pump is 1 plus COP of refrigerator, or in reverse, COP of refrigerator is equals to COP of heat pump minus 1. So this is all about heat engine, heat pump and refrigerator. Okay. Now the unit of refrigeration, the most important definition. What is a unit of refrigeration? So we heard that I purchase a AC of 1 turn or 1.5 turn. Okay. So what is this? So this is a actual unit of refrigeration. So we always bought a AC air conditioner on the basis of tonnage. So 1 turn of refrigeration. So what is the basic unit of refrigeration? So it is called a turn of refrigeration. So 1 turn of refrigeration. What it defines? So it is the amount of latent heat absorbed. Okay. In refrigeration, we are not talking about a sensible heat. We are talking about a latent heat. In our previous video, we observed that when refrigerant pass through evaporator unit, so it is only extract the latent heat of the food content and get vaporized, partially vaporized and move ahead. So what is a ton of refrigeration? So it is the amount of latent heat absorbed by 1 US ton of ice. Remember, this is 1 ton of ice, but it is a 1 ton of US ton, not a metric ton. So latent heat absorbed by 1 US ton of ice during uniform melting from 2 to 0 degree centigrade. That means ice, 1 ton of ice at 0 degree centigrade, it will melt to 0 degree centigrade water in 24 hours. But that melting should be uniform. That means it should not be like that. In a first 20 hours, whole 1 ton of ice get melted. So it will be not uniform. Uniform melting means 1 ton of ice equally melted per unit time, and complete 1 ton of ice will melt exact in 24 hours. And that melting rate should be constant throughout all the hours. So that is called uniform melting. So our 1 ton of ice going to melt exact at 24 hours. Second condition, our complete ice is melting from 0 degree centigrade ice to 0 degree centigrade water. There is no change in temperature. So this is a latent heat. Okay. So second definition, in other word, we can say it is the cooling effect produced by uniform melting of 1 US ton of ice from 2 to 0 degree centigrade. That means these words reflect that from 0 degree centigrade ice to 0 degree centigrade water in 24 hours. So either we can say the amount of latent heat absorbed by ice, so it get melted, or the cooling effect produced by ice during uniform melting in a 24 hours. So this is called a 1 ton of refrigeration. Now imagine, we a little bit elaborate this concept. Imagine there is a one room and we put one US ton of ice there. Okay, and this ice starting melting by absorbing heat from room, and obviously it will absorb latent heat, so it get converted, phase change will be there from solid to liquid form. So this ice will be converted from 0 degree centigrade ice to this water, 0 degree centigrade water. So only absorbing latent heat. And as I said, the mass of ice is a 1 ton, but it is a US ton, and 1 US ton is nothing but a 907 kg. In a metric, 1 metric ton is nothing but a 1000 kg, but 1 US ton is equal to 907 kg. So during calculating ton of refrigeration, we have to use US ton, not a metric ton. So sensible heat, we normally use a sensible heat MCP delta T, where we observe change in temperature, correct? But here we observe that there is no change in temperature, only change in phase, ice to water. So temperature is same. That means we are not using this formula for calculating heat. MCP delta T is not applicable here because there is no change in temperature. We are using latent heat. So latent heat, mass of ice multiplied by latent heat of fusion. Fusion, that means from ice to water or water to ice, whatever be the phase change there, that is latent heat of melting. Here we are melting the ice, so we are using latent heat of melting. What is the latent heat of melting of ice? So it is 335 kilojoule per kg. This standard value, and of course at atmospheric temperature and pressure. So refrigerating effect, that is cooling effect. So mass of ice 1 ton, during its melting it will absorb latent heat. So latent heat of melting of ice divided by time, because it must melt uniformly in 24 hours. So time is there, 24 hours. So mass US ton is equals to 907 kg. So 90 kg of ice multiplied by latent heat 335 divided by 24 hours. Now multiplying this 60, we are converting this 24 hour into minute, and again multiply by 60, we are converting minute into second. So unit wise, this mass is in kg, 907 kg of ice multiply by latent heat of melting of ice is kilojoule per kg, and divided by all this parameter now converted into second. So this kg, kg get cancel. So we obtain after calculation 3.516 kilojoule per second. So this is the actual cooling effect produced by melting of ice during 24 hour uniform melting. And kilojoule per second, we can say it is a kilowatt. So a refrigerating effect or unit of 1 ton of refrigeration is also equals to 3.52 kilowatt. This is the unit of refrigeration. Now the last portion of today's lecture is a reverse Carnot refrigeration cycle. So we are talking about refrigeration cycle. Here we are considering heat sink at T1 temperature, low temperature, heat source at T2 temperature, higher temperature, and we are supplying work. This is heat extracted from sink. So Q sink. And this Q sink plus work.
One question.
Together, sir, as a Q source, we are supplying to heat source. So let us see, we will draw a PV pressure versus volume diagram and TS temperature versus entropy diagram. So this is our first point of Carnot reverse cycle. Remember, our Carnot regular cycle, thermodynamic cycle work in a clockwise direction, but this is a reverse, so it will work in an anti-clockwise direction. This is our first point where pressure is P1 and volume is V1. If I am plotting this, so on TS diagram, so it will be first point here. Now, this is adiabatic, reversible adiabatic compression from 1 to 2. So adiabatic, so PV raised to the power gamma is constant. And if it is adiabatic, that means there is no change in entropy. So if I am drawing this on a TS diagram, so compression process 1 to 2 having same entropy. So there is no change in entropy. This is a compression, adiabatic compression. Now after 2 points, so first it is adiabatic compression up to point 2. Then it is again compressed, but isothermal. So from 2 to 3, it is isothermal compression. After isothermal compression, it will reach to point 3 where pressure P3 and volume V3. If I am drawing this on TS diagram, during isothermal compression, temperature remains same. So 2 to 3, temperature remains same. So it will be horizontal line. This is isothermal compression. Next, expansion. So again, adiabatic expansion from 3 to 4. So expansion process, adiabatic. If adiabatic expansion, so we get a vertical line on TS diagram where entropy remains same. So 3 to 4 is a adiabatic expansion. Now, isothermal expansion. Isothermal expansion means where temperature remains same. That means there is an expansion, but temperature remains same. It reflects that there is a phase change because temperature is not changing. That means there is phase change take place. And during this 4 to 1, we are actually observing refrigerating effect, cooling effect. That means during this process 4 to 1, liquid refrigerant gets changed into vapor refrigerant, and during this phase change, it absorbs latent heat from sink. So on TS diagram, entropy S3 and S4 same, and entropy S1 and S2 same. Temperature wise T1 and T4 same and T2 and T3 same. So remember, this isothermal expansion is the actually cooling effect process where our refrigerant changing phase from liquid to vapor, and we observe cooling effect. How it convert into vapor? Because it is absorbing latent heat from the food content, and so that its phase get change. So here, extraction of sink heat, that is Q sink, is extracted from food content, and as a Q source, we are supplying to the surrounding air. So extraction of heat, so we get cooling effect during this 4 to 1 process. Now T1 is a heat sink temperature, T2 is a heat source temperature, and we are saying that T2 is higher than T1. Now what is the refrigerating effect? We are observing refrigerating effect during the process 4 to 1. So change in entropy is change in heat divided by temperature, because 4 to 1 there is a constant temperature. You can say it is a T1 or you can say it is a T4 because temperature is same, T1 and T4. So change in heat divided by temperature, either T4 or T1. We can rearrange this as a change in heat is equals to change in entropy multiplied by temperature. So change in heat, that is a heat extracted, this is a Q sink, is equals to change in entropy is S1 higher minus S4 lower. So higher minus lower, so S1 minus S4 multiplied by T1. As T1 and T4 is same, so we can say T1 equals to T4. S1 is equals to S2, S4 is equals to S3. So we can write this S1 minus S4 multiplied by T1 is equals to S2 minus S3 multiplied by T4. So this is the cooling effect produced. So refrigerating effect. Now work supplied or compressor work. How much compressor supplying work? So work supplied is heat supplied Q2 to 3 minus Q4 to 1. So heat supplied, that is Q source minus Q sink. So Q source minus Q sink, it is total work done. Q source, that is 2 to 3. So S2 minus S3 multiply by T2. So S2 is higher value, S3 is lower value. So S2 minus S3 multiply by T2 minus heat sink, that is Q sink is S1 minus S4 multiply by T1. Now or on simplifying, we are replacing S2 as a S1 and S3 as a S3, as a S4. So S2 equals to S1. So here S1, S3 equals to S4. So replacing S3 as S4. So it becomes S1 minus S4 multiplied by T2. And second term minus S1 minus S4 multiplied by T1. Now COP. So this is a total net work supply, okay, and this is the cooling effect produced. So what is the COP? COP is refrigerating effect or cooling effect divided by work supply. A refrigerating effect is Q4 to 1, work supply is Q2 to 3 minus Q4 to 1. So refrigerating effect S1 minus S4 multiplied by T1. And work supplied is S1 minus S4 multiplied by T2 minus S1 minus S4 multiplied by T1. Here this bracket get cancelled. So ultimately we observe COP of refrigeration is T1 upon T2 minus T1. That means sink temperature divided by temperature difference of source and sink, as we derive during our refrigeration cycle this process. So it is come same. This formula belongs to same when we are talking about sink temperature as T1, source temperature as T2. If we change the notation, then this formula will be changed.